Hello everyone, good evening, namaste to everybody. Welcome to Unacademy YouTube channel. I am Dr. Chesta Agrawal. Let me check who all are online. If I am loud and clear, give me a thumbs up. Okay, so we'll start. Today my topic is must know images in dermatology. Now, in nowadays, the NEET PG exam, almost one third to half of the total paper has image-based questions. So we should know the images or the clinical pictures of the most common dermatological diseases, which has been asked frequently in exams. So at least we should be well versed with it so that we can solve their question easily. Today I'll show the pictures of the most common diseases which are asked frequently in the exams. Okay, there is one more announcement for you. There is a 6-month batch for interns and post-intern. A concise batch is getting started on April 13th, 2020. Daily live classes from 7:30 will start on Unacademy. Use my referral code CHESKMC2633 to get an extra 10% discount. So please hurry now. Okay. So we'll start. First of all, the dermatological diseases are divided into two groups: the primary lesions and secondary lesions. Hello everybody. Yes, so the dermatological diseases has been classified into primary and secondary. The primary lesions are macules, papules, pustules, plaque. The secondary lesions are crusting, erosions, scaling. So in exams you may get question asking that what all are the primary lesions and what all are the secondary lesions. So it is very important to know these primary and secondary lesions. Okay, so now coming to the first, macule. Today I'll show you the images of important dermatological diseases so that you'll get to know that what, you know, what to identify in the exam. Now, what is macule? This is a flat discoloration of less than 0.5 cm. So you can see there is discoloration of skin. In first picture there is hyperpigmentation, and in second picture there is hypopigmentation. Hello Darshil, welcome. So here we are discussing the macule, the hyperpigmented macule or hypopigmented. So these are flat lesions, they are not raised or depressed, just a flat lesion. Now what is patch? These are similar to macules, but the only difference is the size. The macule is less than 0.5 cm and a patch is more than 0.5 cm. So both the lesions look similar, the only difference is the size. Now coming to second, that is papule. What is papule? These are raised, circumscribed, solid lesion of less than 0.5 cm. So you can look at this picture, these are raised lesion. When you feel or palpate the lesion, they are raised, they are circumscribed lesions and they are solid lesion. Okay, and they are less than 0.5 cm. Next is plaque. What is plaque? When several papule come and join together, they form a plaque. So what is plaque? A papule collises to form a plaque and the size is more than 0.5 cm. So look at this picture. This is a picture of an elbow of a patient which has a plaque. So these are small multiple papules which are joined to form a plaque. Okay. Coming to the next picture, fluid filled lesions. They are divided into two parts. First is vesicle and second is bulle. So what are these? Vesicles are less than 0.5 cm. So these are small fluid containing lesions of less than 0.5 cm. These are called as vesicles. And when the fluid filled lesion of more than 0.5 cm, this is called as bulle. So what are the two different type of fluid filled lesions? Vesicle of 0.5 cm, less than 0.5, and bulle of more than 0.5 cm. Next is nodule. What are these? These are solid, raised as well as deep circumscribed lesion of skin of more than 0.5 cm. So what is the difference between papule and nodule? The difference is, there are two differences between papules and nodules. Both are solid raised lesion, but nodule has a deeper component. There is a depth also. So there is a deep circumscribed component of the nodule, and the second difference is the size is more than 0.5 cm. So these are the two differences between a nodule and a papule. The next is wheal. What are these wheals? These are evanescent structures. Evanescent means the lesion will disappear within 24 hours. So they are short, for a short duration. So they are evanescent raised erythematous area of variable size. So they can be small size also, they can be of a large size also, and they are associated with itching. So these are evanescent structures which are associated with itching. These are characteristic feature of urticaria. In some cases, these veals can even persist for more than 24 hours. In those cases, if it persists for more than 24 hours, then the diagnosis can be urticarial vasculitis, where the blood vessels get involved, so it remains for a longer duration. So these are the veals' characteristic clinical feature of urticaria. Next is petechiae and papule. Both are the same. The only difference is the size. In petechiae, the size is 1 to 2 mm, while in purpura, the size is more than 2 mm. Purpura can be palpable also, and this is a characteristic clinical feature of small vessel vasculitis, or which is also called as leukocytoclastic vasculitis. Next comes the telangiectasia. These are visible dilatation of small cutaneous blood vessels. So it is very important. So you should at least differentiate what is telangiectasia. We see it nowadays very commonly in this era when steroids are more and more used by the patients for everything. Nowadays, over-the-counter sale of steroids can lead to thinning of the skin and the appearance of the subcutaneous or the vessels which are present in the dermis. Because of the thinness of the skin, we can easily see those vessels. So telangiectasia is very common. Now, these are few of the examples that how these questions can come into your exam. Now, let's solve this question. The first question is neither raised nor depressed. So what is the answer? It is a macule, a plaque, a nodule, or a papule. So please answer this question. Darshil, Surekha, you want to answer this question? Yes, Deepu, you are right. The answer to this question is macule. They have said that it is neither raised nor depressed. It means it is a flat lesion. So a flat lesion is called as macule. If it is less than 0.5 cm, then it is macule, and if it is more than 0.5 cm, then it is a patch. Now coming to the second question, a flat discoloration on the skin, which is 1 cm in size, skin of 1 cm size. Anand, what is the answer? Please again read the question properly. So the answer is patch because the size is 1 cm. Less than 0.5 is macule, more than 0.5 it is a patch. So you can get these kind of questions in the exams. So please understand it properly. They are very easy and you should know. Another question which I have told you, they can even ask you what among the following is a primary lesion and which is a secondary lesion. So you should at least know what are the primary lesions and what are the secondary lesions. Now coming to the infectious disease. In infectious disease, mainly we read about skin tuberculosis, fungal infections, bacterial infections, viral infections. So you should know how these diseases have their clinical picture, how they appears clinically, so that you can solve the questions easily. First, coming to lupus vulgaris, this is an example of skin tuberculosis. Whenever a patient has a good immunity and because of some endogenous spread, if a patient has tuberculosis of lungs, there is endogenous spread of this tuberculous bacilli and it can cause lupus vulgaris. So this is skin tuberculosis. How does it appears clinically? Clinically, it appears as a dusky red or brown. So this is a dusky red or brown plaque with central clearing. So they have an active border and centrally they are scarring and clearing. The third is dioscopy. On looking under the dioscopy, there is a classical appearance called as apple jelly nodules. So you can get question asking that a patient has a red plaque. On dioscopy, there was apple jelly nodules. What is the diagnosis? So answer here is lupus vulgaris. So this is a classical picture of lupus vulgaris, a dusky brown appearance with central scarring. So wherever this word scarring comes, it should click in your mind that they are asking a question from skin tuberculosis. So I have given you an example. A young boy presented with a lesion over his right buttock, which had peripheral scaling and central clearing with scarring. The investigation of the choices. The option one is Zanck smear, second is KOH preparation, third is biopsy, and fourth is Seberod's agar. So what is the answer? Okay, so Darshil has asked me what is the difference between scrofuloderma and lichen's sclerophorosorum. Okay, I'll explain you. See, skin tuberculosis, they have divided the skin tuberculosis depending on the immunity of the patient. If the patient has a good immunity, then it can have two type of skin tuberculosis. One is lupus vulgaris and the other one is tuberculosis verruca cutis. Tuberculosis verruca cutis, it occurs because of the exogenous exposure. Like if a child sit for a defecation in the outside area and it has a prick or exposure of that site, then it will develop tuberculosis verruca cutis. And if there is endogenous spread, if the patient has lung tuberculosis or any other organs tuberculosis and there is endogenous spread of the bacteria, then it will form lupus vulgaris. So these are the examples of the good immunity of a patient and the exogenous or endogenous skin that forms scrofuloderma. So this is a case of a patient with poor immunity and secondary involvement of the superficial skin in case of TB lymphadenitis, that is scrofuloderma. Now, what is lichen scrofulosorum? Now, what is it? This is tuberculate. What is tuberculate? These are id eruptions, hypersensitivity reaction to tuberculosis, where the focus of tuberculosis is somewhere else. Suppose a patient has tuberculosis of lungs, then it can have development of skin lesions like lichen scrofulosorum, like papillonecrotic tuberculate. On examining these lesions, on taking the biopsy, there is no tuberculous organism in them. These are just the hypersensitivity reaction. While the scrofuloderma, this is on taking the biopsy, we see the bacteria in them. So these are the difference. The tuberculates are just the hypersensitivity reactions, and the scrofuloderma on examining there, this is not just the hypersensitivity, there is presence of bacteria also in them. Okay, now many students have answered this question. The answer of this question is biopsy, not KOH preparation. Why there is biopsy? See, here the patient gives a history that he has a lesion over the right buttock. So maybe the boy, young boy, has a habit of defecating outside. So this is the exposure to the external surface or the extensor surface. So he developed a lesion with peripheral scaling and central scarring. When there is central clearing, not scarring, then the answer can be KOH preparation, considering that this is dermatophytic infection. But here we are dealing with the central scarring. It means it is a case of skin tuberculosis. And for skin tuberculosis, the investigation of choice is biopsy. Okay, there is no KOH preparation. The answer is skin biopsy. You can see the tuberculate granulomas in them. Okay, option number one, Zank smear, it is wrong. Zank smear is used for vesiculobullous disorders like pemphigus vulgaris. KOH preparation is also wrong because it is used for dermatophytic infection. Dermatophytic, these are superficial fungal infections. These are not tubercular infections. And fourth is seborrheic dexus agar. This is a culture medium for a fungal infection, not for tuberculosis. Okay, so answer to this question is number three, biopsy. Now the another question, true about lupus vulgaris is all except. First, apple jelly nodules. Second, tuberculosis of skin. Third is also known as scrofuloderma. And fourth is ATT is helpful. So what is the answer to this question? What is the answer to this question? True about lupus vulgaris? Okay, so it is very easy. We have just read on dioscopy, apple jelly nodules are seen. Yes. So option number one is correct. Option number two, TB of skin, this is also correct. This is an example of tuberculosis of skin. Third, also known as scrofuloderma. No, this is not known as scrofuloderma. It is another entity which presents in individuals with the low immunity. The option number fourth, ATT is helpful. Yes, it is a correct answer. So ATT is helpful. So the wrong answer here is option number three, also known as scrofuloderma. Rest all options are correct. Okay, now coming to the next picture, tuberculosis verruca cutis. This is also an example of skin tuberculosis. The characteristic clinical appearance is presence of verrucous lesion. So can you differentiate between this lesion and the previous lupus vulgaris lesion? The lupus vulgaris was a red colored plaque with central scarring. Here it is verrucous. Verrucous means the patient, the superficial surface is rough. So whenever a patient comes with this lesion, one more thing should come into your mind. That is subcutaneous fungal infection, that is chromoblastomycosis. Chromoblastomycosis also present with this kind of verrucous plaque. So you have to always keep in your mind another possibility of chromoblastomycosis along with tuberculosis verruca cutis. You have to then further do biopsy, or you can do MT test, or you can do KOH examination if it is a patient of chromoblastomycosis. Okay, so this is a clinical picture of tuberculosis verruca cutis. Okay. Now coming to the bacterial infection. So those were the example of skin tuberculosis. Now coming to the impetigo, which is a superficial bacterial infection. I have discussed this in detail in my previous YouTube classes. I'll discuss it in brief one more time. It is a superficial bacterial infection which is mainly caused by Staphylococcus aureus and Streptococcus. It is highly contagious. It is usually of two types, bullous and non-bullous. The bullous impetigo, it is mainly caused by Staph aureus. It occurs because of the exotoxin F released by the bacteria. This causes superficial bulla formation in case of bullous impetigo. In case of non-bullous impetigo, which is also called as impetigo contagiosa, it is because of Streptococcus. It occurs like a honey crust appearance. So you can look, the patient initially develops vesicle which soon ruptures and forms superficial crusting. And these crusting have a typical honey-colored appearance. So if in exams they ask you the honey-colored appearance is present in, so the answer is impetigo. The most commonly affected site is face and the upper lip. So these are the sites of predilection. So this is a photo of impetigo. Now coming to second, that is staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. This is a picture of a child with a scarlet skin syndrome. There you can see erythema and tenderness of the skin, and there is superficial peeling of the skin in thin sheets. Here you can see there is peeling of the skin in thin sheets. There is one more entity called as toxic epidermal necrolysis. It is very similar to staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. The only difference is the prognosis is bad in 10, and the second thing is there is constitutional symptoms in the child. The child will have fever, there will be lot of constitutional symptoms. So the prognosis of the child is poor in case of toxic epidermal necrolysis, but the clinical picture is almost same. Oral involvement is most common in that TEN, less common in staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. Next is the viral infection herpes zoster. This is caused by varicella zoster virus. Now this is the same virus which causes varicella in infants. What happens in childhood, that varicella virus, it remains dormant in the dorsal root ganglions. Whenever the patient have decreased immunity, maybe because of some immunocompromised viral infections like HIV, or if patient develops some acute illness, or if patient develops malignancy, there is reactivation of this virus and it descends down in the distribution of single nerve. So you can see that there is a dermatomal distribution of these lesions. What is the classical clinical presentation? There is presence of multiple grouped vesicles in a segmental distribution. Why it is segmentally distributed? Because it descends through a single dermatome. So there is only one dermatome involved. There is few examples in which herpes zoster can be multidermatomal. The example is when the patient is immunocompromised, but in most of the cases it is in a single dermatome. So whenever you see the patient with this grouped vesicles over the single dermatome, and patients give history of burning sensation, patient give history of severe pain, sometimes pain precedes the clinical symptoms. So whenever these kind of history given in the exam, then it should click in your mind that the patient is of herpes zoster, which is caused by varicella zoster virus. Second is herpes genitalis. This is caused by herpes simplex 2. The clinical feature is the patient will have multiple small grouped vesicle which soon ruptures to form superficial ulcers. Here you can see superficial ulcers. Okay, so painful vesicles which rapidly erode to form polycyclic ulcers with an erythematous base. This is a classical example of herpes genitalis. Herpes simplex is the superficial vesicular infection of the lips which is caused by herpes simplex virus 1. There you can see multiple group lesions over the lips or over the face. The only difference here that it is caused by HSV2 most commonly, and that is caused by herpes simplex virus 1 most commonly. Otherwise the clinical feature is same, that is painful vesicles which soon rupture to form polycyclic ulcers. Patient will give you history of burning sensation and pain before developing these vesicular lesions. Another viral infection which is important is chickenpox or varicella. This is caused by varicella. Here the clinical feature is you will see discrete vesicles. There is discrete vesicles which are thin-walled and they are superficial with erythematous base. So this will look like a dew drop on a rose petal. They are very clear, like a drop of water on a rose petal. So because of the presence of the erythematous base, the appearance is called as dew drop on a rose petal appearance. So this is very important, and you should know the history. They can give you a small history that a child or adult have a fever and soon he develop multiple vesicular lesions all over the body. The lesions have clear fluid filled vesicles with erythematous base, and in some cases there is central umbilications also visible in these cases. So this is a classical example of chicken pox and varicella. Now coming to the fungal infection, nowadays in many exams you see question from dermatophytic infections because there are many very common in our general practice. So how does it look? The dermatophytic infection, it looks like annular lesion with relative clearing in the center. So you can see here, this is an annular lesion with central clearing and there is fine superficial scaling. Okay, so dermatophytic infections are classified depending on the site. If it is present over the scalp, it is called as stenia capitis. If it is present over the face, it is called as stenia faciae. If it is present over the hand, this is an example of stenia manum because this is the hand of the patient. If it is present over the foot, then it is called as stenia pedis. So depending upon the area, and in general, if it is present over the body, we name it as stenia corporis. And if it is present in the flexures of groin, then it is called as stenia cruris. Presentation is same, annular lesion with relative clearing in the center and active periphery or fine scaling of the periphery. Next is inflammatory stenia capitis. Stenia capitis is divided into inflammatory type and non-inflammatory type. In non-inflammatory type, we have gray patch and black dot, and in inflammatory type, we have chorion and favus. So this is an example of chorion where you see a bogey swelling over the scalp of a patient with associated hair fall. There may be discharge of pus in few cases also. And this is favus. Here you can see yellow colored cup-like structure which is called as cutula. This type of stenia infection, this type of inflammatory stenia capitis is usually seen in immunocompromised individual. So chorion and favus, these are example of inflammatory stenia. Now few of the questions. An 8-year-old boy presents with bogey swelling and easily pluckable hair. What is the diagnosis? So I have just now discussed it. You want to answer this question. An 8-year-old boy present with bogey swelling and easily pluckable hair. The diagnosis is first stenia capitis, second alopecia areata. The option is repeated once again. Third, that is stenia capitis, and fourth is lichen planus. So answer is yes, first and third. And no, Darshil, this is not lichen planus. This is an example. The patient has bogey swelling. It means that here we are dealing with an inflammatory stenia capitis. Mostly this is a favus. This is a chorion, the presence of the bogey swelling over the scalp. So Chetan, Sonia and Devkant, you all are right. Now coming to the next picture, this is also a fungal infection which is called as pityriasis versicolor. This is caused by a species called as Malassezia furfur. It is mainly present over the upper chest or upper back, which occurs mainly because of the sweat accumulation. Now what happens, what is the clinical picture here? You get to see hypopigmented, this is the hypopigmented macules which is mainly at the perifollicular area, and there is superficial fine scaling. Now why there is hypopigmented area? This is because of secretion of carboxylic acid by this Malassezia furfur species, and this carboxylic acid decreases the tanning of the skin. So it causes relatively hypopigmented lesion. But in few individuals, you may get hyperpigmented lesions also. That's why it is called as versicolor. Versicolor means variable colors. So here there is hypopigmented or hyperpigmented lesions, which is mainly perifollicular, and there is superficial fine scaling. If we rub these scales, there is exaggeration of these scales. So this is also one of the tests which you can do clinically. On doing the KOH examination, you get to see spaghetti and meatball appearance. So pityriasis versicolor is very common, and this is the appearance which you can see. This is the fine scaling hypopigmented lesion. Now this is a question, please solve this question. A 24-year-old man had multiple small hypopigmented macules on the upper chest and back for the last 3 months. The macule were circular, arranged around the follicles, and may coalesce to form large sheets. The surface of the macule shows fine scaling. He had similar lesion 1 year ago, which subsided with treatment. The most appropriate investigation to confirm the diagnosis is. So what is the answer to this question? So split this question. What they have asked? He is a 24-year-old male with multiple hypopigmented macule. So look at this picture. He has multiple hypopigmented macules. Few are discrete and few are confluent. They are mainly at a perifollicular area. These show fine scaling, and patient gives a history of similar episodes previous year also. So the diagnosis here is, this is a case of pityriasis versicolor. So pityriasis versicolor is caused by Malassezia furfur species. So what is the answer? Yes, you all are right. Pradeep, Vanaja, Sonia, Devkanta, everybody is right. So the answer to this question is KOH examination. And on doing the KOH examination, you will see spaghetti or meatball appearance. So few of the, in Indian textbook, instead of spaghetti and meatball, they have given it a name as banana and grape. They told that spaghetti and meatball, it is a foreign term, so we can use the term banana and grape appearance also. So if they ask you in question banana and grape appearance, it is the same thing like spaghetti and meatball. Coming to the next question, a 30-year-old female presents with history of itching under the right breast. On examination, annular ring lesion was present under the breast. The diagnosis is, so here the question says that a 30-year-old female has annular lesion over the breast, just below the breast. So what is the diagnosis? Trichophyton rubrum species, Candida albicans, Epidermophyton or Microsporum. So do you want to answer this question? What is the answer to this question? A patient with annular lesion under the breast with associated itching. Yes, Sairam, you are right. Anybody else want to answer? No, Pratik, you are wrong. See, now this is a case of tinea cruris or tinea corporis. It is a dermatophytic infection. Now, most common dermatophytic infection which is present nowadays is caused by Trichophyton species, and that too Trichophyton rubrum and Trichophyton mentagrophyte. So the dry scaly lesions are mainly caused by rubrum, and erythematous lesions are mainly caused by mentagrophyte. So answer here is Trichophyton rubrum. Candida albicans, the candida lesions are usually, they can present with intertriginous lesions also, but they have small pustules and satellite lesions, which is not seen in this case. Epidermophyton and Microsporum species rarely cause dermatophytic infection. They do cause, but the most common, if in options they have given you Trichophyton rubrum, then answer is Trichophyton. Otherwise, Epidermophyton and Microsporum can also cause, but the best possible answer is Trichophyton rubrum. Okay, now coming to the next question, a 36-year-old worker developed itchy annular scaly plaque on both the groins. The application of a corticosteroid ointment led to temporary relief, but the plaque continued to extend at the periphery. Which is the most likely diagnosis? So here a photo is given, a groin of a patient with erythematous lesion. You can see some striae also here. There is development of some striae. So what is the most likely diagnosis? Erythema annulare centrifugum, granula annulare, annular LP or tinea cruris? Yes, so most of the student is right. Darshil, this is not erythema annulare centrifugum. See, in this groin region, the patient has applied steroids. On application of steroid, there was only temporary relief. So there is temporary relief. It means it is not an inflammatory pathology. It is some infective pathology. The ESC, it is an inflammatory pathology. So it should respond to the application of corticosteroid. But here it is an infective pathology. So even on application of corticosteroid, there was only temporary relief followed by extension of the lesion in the periphery. So here the most likely diagnosis is tinea cruris. And because of application of steroid, there is secondary changes like this dry formation. There is, here you can see pustules also if it is visible. So this is an example of tinea cruris. Yes, you are right, Pradeep, Sunil, Sapna, Vijana. I think almost everybody is right. I'll explain you later that how the how the clinical features of erythema annulare centrifugum will present. Now coming to the next part of the infectious disease, that is mycetoma. These are subcutaneous fungal infections. How does these subcutaneous fungal infections present? These subcutaneous fungal infections, they usually present with these kind of lesions. So what are these lesions? These lesions are subcutaneous nodules with draining sinuses. So what is mycetoma? Mycetoma is caused by the fungus. This is an example of subcutaneous fungus which is caused by two group of organism, eumycotic or actinomycotic. Eumycotic example is Madurella mycetoma, and actinomycotic the example is Nocardia species. So most of the time when there is, because of the presence of the barefoot walking in our country, especially in farmers, there is trauma to the the exposed sites like the foot or the hand, and this lead to inoculation of the fungal infection to the subcutaneous tissue, which leads to formation of subcutaneous nodules. There is surrounding erythema and there is discharging sinuses. So these sinuses discharge some granules which can be yellow color, which can be white color and black color. The what are these granules? These granules are the presence of these fungal species. On looking under the microscope, you can see different type of fungus, and depending on the size of the granules and the color of granules, you can make out whether it is eumycotic fungus or actinomycotic fungus. So in exam, you can get a question asking that a farmer or a person who has a habit of barefoot walking develop a subcutaneous nodule over the foot which have discharging sinuses, and patient also report a discharge of some crust or some granules. So what is the diagnosis? So diagnosis here is mycetoma. Okay, so this is very important. You can get questions asking, giving this photo and asking questions according to it. What is the treatment? You give antifungals like oral antifungal, itraconazole, etc. Next is sporotrichosis. This is also an example of subcutaneous fungal infection. So this is caused by Sporothrix schenkii. What is the classical feature here? The classical feature is you see the lesion in the single, the linear pattern. Here you can see the lesion in the linear pattern. Why this is present in a linear pattern? Because this fungus infection spread through the lymphatics, so they are present in a linear pattern. So whenever in exam they give you a history that a patient develop multiple nodules which ulcerate and they develop in a single or a linear pattern, and the patient gives a chronic history, what is the diagnosis? So diagnosis here is sporotrichosis. This is very classical of it. So you may get question in the exams, and this picture is very important. Next is chromoblastomycosis. This is also a deep fungal or a subcutaneous fungal infection. I have discussed this in detail in my live classes. This is a varicose plaque, and you should keep in your mind TVC as one of the DD. I have told you before only that tuberculosis verruca cutis can also present with the varicose plaque over the exposed area or a trauma prone sites like foot, hands. So chromoblastomycosis can also be the one of the DD. Now coming to the parasitic infections. What is the example? Scabies. Okay, so scabies, what is the pathognomonic lesion of scabies? The burrow is the most common site. So burrow, what is the classical lesions? The classical lesion is presence of burrow. Second is these burrows are present in the stratum corneum, and scalp, face, palm, sole are usually spared. So this scabies is caused by Sarcoptes species. This is a disease of poor psychosocial condition or where the local hygiene is not good. So this is called as a water wash disease. Those people who do not wash their clothes or do not have bath daily, they develop this kind of disease, especially where there is overcrowding. So they can develop these burrow-like lesions. Now this picture have shown a circle of Hebra. This is the most common site where these scabies lesions are present. That is periumbilical area, groin region, that is finger webs, over the elbow and over the axilla. So whenever in your OPDs or whenever in exam, if you get a question, you have to see whether the patient have disease, what is the site, whether it is periumbilical, it is groin region, axilla, and most of the time this kind of itching is more at night. So you have to think about the history also. This is the web space. You can see the small papular lesions. This is the burrow. I have zoomed this area. This is an example of a burrow. This is very classical, present at the stratum corneum level. So this is a question. Burrow in scabies is seen in option number 1, stratum germinativum, stratum corneum, malphigian layer or dermis. So what is the answer? Burrow in scabies is seen in, I have just told you, the answer is stratum corneum. So like this you can get questions from scabies. Another question is, a 6-month-old infant presented with multiple papules and exudative lesions on the face, scalp, trunk and few vesicles on palms and soles for 2 weeks. His mother has a history of itchy lesions. The most likely diagnosis is, option number 1 is scabies, second is infantile eczema, third is infantile seborrheic dermatitis and fourth is impetigo contagiosa. So what is the answer to this question? I think students are answering, but see, the answer to this question is scabies. Now why scabies? We have just now read that the face, scalp and palms and soles are spared. But in this question, the 6-month-old patient have face, scalp, palm and sole involvement. So what is the difference in the presentation of scabies in adult and in infant? In infant, the face, scalp and palm and soles, all 4 are involved. Why there is sparing of face and scalp in case of adult is because of presence of seborrhea or the seborrheic gland activity. The seborrheic gland has, the seborrheic component has anti-scabitic action. So face and scalp have lot of seborrheic glands. That is why in adult patient there is no involvement of face or scalp. While in small infant or less than 1 year old infant, there is no seborrheic activity. So face, scalp, palm and sole, all the 4 areas can be involved. Another clue in this question is presence of the itching in the mother. In rest 3, like infantile eczema, infantile seborrheic dermatitis, there is no positive history in mother. As it is an infective condition, so mother is also exposed, so there is a positive history in mother also. So answer here is scabies. Yes, Surekha, you are right. It is because of the presence of family history, and in infant, the palm, soles and the trunk, face and scalp, all the 4 are involved in case of an infant. Now coming to the papulosquamous disorder, the most common papulosquamous disorders is psoriasis. How does the clinical lesion of psoriasis appear? Look at this picture. There is a well-defined plaque. Here you can see a well-defined erythematous plaque. This is called a salmon pink appearance, and with presence of white thick silvery scales. So this is a classical lesion, erythematous plaque with superficial silvery white thick scales. So this is an example of psoriasis. Now coming to a question, a patient presents with erythematous scaly lesions on the extensor aspect of elbow and knee. The clinical diagnosis is, so if the picture which I have shown in the previous slide, suppose that picture is asked with this question, that a patient present with the erythematous scaly lesions of the extensor surface, then what is the clinical diagnosis? So the diagnosis here would be psoriasis. Now to coming to the diagnosis, which test we will use among these 4? Option number 1 is Auspitz sign, option number 2 is KOH smear, option number 3 is Zank smear and option number 4 is skin biopsy. Yes, most of you are right. The clinical diagnosis is got by Auspitz sign. Now what is Auspitz sign? I have seen that they have asked frequently questions from this Auspitz sign. So there are 3 steps of Auspitz sign. First is, we will rub the lesion of psoriasis with a glass slide. This rubbing will cause accentuation of scale. This is called as garotage sign. Second is, on rubbing, there is a, after removing the scales, we'll find a thin membrane which is called as Berkeley's membrane. Okay, so this is the point number 2. On removing this Berkeley's membrane, there is pinpoint bleeding. This is called as Auspitz sign positive. So there are three steps in auspid sign. First is the garrotage test, where we'll rub the existing plaque of psoriasis so that there will be accentuation of scale. Second is, on removing that scale, there is thin membrane which is called as Berkeley's membrane. And third step is, on removal of that Berkeley's membrane, there is pinpoint bleeding. So this three step is called as auspid sign. So answer here would be option number one. Now coming to next question, a patient with psoriasis was started on systemic steroids. After stopping the treatment, patient developed universally red scaly skin with plaques losing their margin all over his body. The most likely diagnosis is, here you can see a picture. Options are drug induced reaction, second is pustular psoriasis, third is bacterial infection, and fourth is erythrodermic psoriasis. So what is the answer to this question? We'll split the question that a patient of psoriasis which was started on systemic steroids, and on stopping the steroid, there is development of universally red scaly skin. So what is the diagnosis? Yes, the answer to this question is erythrodermic psoriasis. Now, what is erythroderma? The erythroderma is presence of scaling and redness of the skin of more than 90% of the surface area. So here you can see the whole skin is erythematous with scaling. What happens when you give steroids in a case of psoriasis? When you give steroid and you suddenly withdraw the steroids, what happens? The discreteness of the psoriatic plaques, the plaques of the psoriasis, they lose their margin and they become diffuse, leading to generalized erythema and erythroderma like picture. So steroids should be avoided in the cases of psoriasis, because it is a very life-threatening condition if a patient goes into erythrodermic psoriasis. How does pustular psoriasis look like? Pustular psoriasis will look like a uniform sheath of fine pustules which are mainly present at the subcorneal level. So there is no pustule in this picture. So the answer of this picture is erythrodermic psoriasis. Why it is not drug-induced rash? Because here there is no particular drug is given. It is just that on withdrawing the drug, the patient develop this kind of lesion. If on starting any drug, patient develop this lesion, then this is a drug-induced reaction. So answer to this question is psoriasis. And another important is, we should not give systemic steroid in a patient of psoriasis. Okay, so answer is number 4. Next question, pitting nail dystrophy is seen in. A photo is given here where you can see pitting. Option is, first, dermatophytic infection, second is psoriasis, third is lichen planus, and fourth is seborrheic dermatitis. So this kind of pitting is seen in which disease? Yes, answer to this question is psoriasis. Nail changes in psoriasis is very important. In almost 10 to 50% of individuals, you can see the nail changes. What are the classical nail changes? There is presence of pitting. Why there is pitting? This is because of the defect in the nail matrix. So you can see the pitting. The pitting of psoriasis is non-uniform, and the pitting of alopecia areata is uniform. So they can give you an example. They can give you an exam that a patient develops non-uniform pitting. Then what is the diagnosis? So diagnosis will be psoriasis. What are the other nail findings? There is presence of onycholysis. Onycholysis means, here you can see there is presence of onycholysis, that is separation of the nail plate from the nail bed. So this is called as onycholysis. Third is oil drop sign. Fourth is subungual hemorrhages or subungual hyperkeratosis. So these are some of the nail findings of psoriasis. Coming to the next papillosquamous disease, that is lichen planus. Lichen planus, how does its clinical appearances? You can see violaceous, shiny, flat, topped polygonal papules. You can remember it as 4 P's, that is plain topped papules which are polygonal in shape. What is Wickham's tri? On seeing under the magnifying lens, you can see the white colored lacy appearance over these lesions. These are called as Wickham's tri. Coming to the question, a 30-year-old male presented with pruritic flat-topped polygonal shiny violaceous papule with flexural distribution. The most likely diagnosis is, so I think now the question is very easy. They have given you the classical presentation of lichen planus, that is the pruritic flat topped or plain topped polygonal violaceous papules with flexural distribution. So the answer to this question will be 3. Yes, Darshil, the 4 P's are pruritic, plain topped, polygonal and papule. So the answer here would be option number 3. Coming to the next question, a young lady presents with lacy lesions in the oral cavity. So this is a picture, the presence of lacy, these are the lacy lesions in the oral cavity, and her proximal nail fold has extended onto the nail bed. So here you can see that this is the proximal nail fold, it has extended up to the nail bed. What is the likely diagnosis? The options are psoriasis, geographic tongue, lichen planus or candidiasis. Yes, you all are right, the answer is lichen planus. So now you'll understand how does lichen planus present in the oral cavity. This is a classical presentation. The patient will develop white lacy appearance over the buccal mucosa. Patient will give you a history of burning sensation while having food. The nail changes, in nail changes, this is called as pterygium, where the proximal nail fold extend up to the nail bed. This is also very common in case of lichen planus. Now coming to the next papulosquamous disease, that is pityriasis rosea. Pityriasis rosea, the classical presentation is presence of a herald patch. The primary lesion, the herald patch is also called as the mother patch. This is a large size patch. This is a patch of herald. What is collarette of scale? The pityriasis rosea have a classical scales which are adhered to the lesion from the periphery and they are free from inside. So collarette of scale means adhered or attached from the periphery and centrally they are free. Christmas tree appearances, in look at this photo. This is a back of a photo with the lesions of pityriasis rosea. So it looks like a Christmas tree appearance. So lesion may present like a Christmas tree appearance. So in your exams, they can give any of this word. They can give you herald patch and they can ask you the question. They can give you collarette of scale is seen in which disease, and they can give you Christmas tree appearance, or they can give you the photo and they can ask you that which disease caused this. So I have given you a question, pityriasis rosea, all are true except first, it is a self-limiting condition. Second, herald patch is seen. Third, caused by dermatophyte. And fourth is collarette of scales. So what is the answer to this question? Amit, you are partially right. Option number 3 is wrong. Option number 1 is correct. It is a self-limiting condition that if you'll do nothing to this patient, then also patient will improve. And there is a history of recurrence also. So this is a self-limiting condition which have a tendency to recur. So option number 1 is correct. Option number 2, herald patch, yes. These are the mother patches which you can see in these individuals. Option number 3, caused by dermatophyte, no. This is, the etiology is unknown, but in few reports, the infection with HHV-7 or 6, HHV-6 or 7 is reported. But most of the cases, the etiology is unknown. The option number 4, collarette of scale, yes. The scales are present, the attached to the border and free from the inside. So all are true except option number 3. So this is all. Tomorrow I'll discuss in more detail. This is the infective pathology and papulosquamous. The rest of the examples, like from vesicular bullous disorders, malignancies and connective tissue disorder, I'll discuss everything in detail in my tomorrow's class at 6:30. So okay, good night, and I'll teach you the rest of the section tomorrow. Bye bye. Thank you.